Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Cross and the Lynching Tree by James H. Cone. Read by Leon Nixon. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. Acts 10:39. The South is crucifying Christ again. By all the laws of ancient rote and rule, Christ's awful sin is that he's dark of hue, the sin for which no blamelessness atones. And while he burns, good men and women too shout, battling for his black and brittle bones. Christ Recrucified, County Cullen, 1922. Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root, black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Strange Fruit, Abel Meeropol, a.k.a. Lewis Allen. Perhaps nothing about the history of mob violence in the United States is more surprising than how quickly an understanding of the full horror of lynching has receded from the nation's collective historical memory. W. Fitzhugh Brundage, Lynching in the New South. Introduction. What was it that made me conscious of possibilities? From where in the southern darkness had I caught a sense of freedom? Why was it that I was able to act upon vaguely felt emotions? It had been through books that I had managed to keep myself alive, and that had evoked in me vague glimpses of life's possibilities. Richard Wright. Theme for Negro writers will emerge when they have begun to feel the meaning of the history of the race as though they, in one lifetime, had lived it themselves throughout all of the long centuries. Richard Wright. The cross and the lynching tree are separated by nearly 2,000 years. One is the universal symbol of Christian faith. The other is the quintessential symbol of black oppression in America. Though both are symbols of death, one represents a message of hope and salvation, while the other signifies the negation of that message by white supremacy. Despite the obvious similarities between Jesus' death on a cross and the death of thousands of black men and women strung up to die on a lamppost or tree, relatively few people, apart from black poets, novelists, and other reality-seeing artists, have explored the symbolic connections. Yet I believe this is a challenge we must face. What is at stake is the credibility and promise of the Christian gospel and the hope that we may heal the wounds of racial violence that continue to divide our churches and our society. In its heyday, the lynching of black Americans was no secret. It was a public spectacle, often announced in advance in newspapers and over radios, attracting crowds of up to 20,000 people. An unspeakable crime. It is a memory that most white Americans would prefer to forget. For African Americans, the memory of disfigured black bodies swinging in the southern breeze is so painful that they too try to keep those horrors buried deep down in their consciousness until, like a dormant volcano, they erupt uncontrollably, causing profound agony and pain. But as with the evils of chattel slavery and Jim Crow segregation, blacks and whites and other Americans who want to understand the true meaning of the American experience need to remember lynching. To forget this atrocity leaves us with a fraudulent perspective of this society and of the meaning of the Christian gospel for this nation. While the lynching tree is seldom discussed or depicted, the cross is one of the most visible symbols of America's Christian origins. Many Christians embrace the conviction that Jesus died on the cross to redeem humankind from sin. Taking our place, Jesus suffered on the cross and gave his life a ransom for many. Mark chapter 10, verse 45. We are now justified by God's grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. Romans chapter 3, verses 24 through 25. The cross is the great symbol of the Christian narrative of salvation. Unfortunately, during the course of 2,000 years of Christian history, this symbol of salvation has been detached from any reference to the ongoing suffering and oppression of human beings, those whom Ignacio Ellacuría, the Salvadoran martyr, called the crucified peoples of history. The cross has been transformed into a harmless, non-offensive ornament that Christians wear around their necks. Rather than reminding us of the cost of discipleship, it has become a form of cheap grace, an easy way to salvation that doesn't force us to confront the power of Christ's message and mission. Until we can see the cross and the lynching tree together, until we can identify Christ with a re-crucified black body hanging from a lynching tree, there can be no genuine understanding of Christian identity in America, and no deliverance from the brutal legacy of slavery and white supremacy. I was born in Arkansas, a lynching state. During my childhood, white supremacy ruled supreme. White people were virtually free to do anything to blacks with impunity. The violent crosses of the Ku Klux Klan were a familiar reality, and white racists preached a dehumanizing, segregated gospel in the name of Jesus' cross every Sunday. And yet, in rural black churches, I heard a different message, as preachers proclaimed the message of the suffering Jesus and the salvation accomplished in his death on the cross. I noticed how the passion and energy of the preacher increased whenever he talked about the cross, and the congregation responded with outbursts of Amen and Hallelujah that equaled the intensity of the sermon oration. People shouted, clapped their hands, and stomped their feet as if a powerful, living reality of God's Spirit had transformed them from nobodies in white society to somebodies in the black church. This black religious experience, with all its tragedy and hope, was the reality in which I was born and raised. Its paradoxes and incongruities have shaped everything I have said and done. If I have anything to say on the Christian community in America and around the world, it is rooted in the tragic and hopeful reality that sustains and empowers black people to resist the forces that seem designed to destroy every ounce of dignity in their souls and bodies. This work is a continuation and culmination of all my previous books, each of them, in different ways, motivated by a central question: how to reconcile the gospel message of liberation with the reality of black oppression. But in many ways, this book is particularly personal. Its subject brings me back to my first memories of hearing the gospel, as well as back to primal memories of terror and violence that were part of the reality of growing up in the Jim Crow South. As a child, I watched my mother and father deal with segregation and the threats of lynching, and was deeply affected by their examples and by the sacrifices they made to keep their children safe. Through the black religious experience, I caught a vision of my possibility, entered the Christian ministry in the African Methodist Episcopal Church, and made my way to college and seminary, and received a Ph.D. in theology at Garrett Biblical Institute, now Garrett Evangelical Theological Seminary, and Northwestern University in 1965. My journey was long and hard, but I was determined to be more than what America had intended for me. Just as books kept Richard Wright alive and gave him vague glimpses of life's possibilities, the black church and theological texts kept me wrestling with life and faith, trying to find meaning in a society and an intellectual discourse that did not even acknowledge that I existed. How could I find meaning in a world that ignored black people? I decided that I had to say something about that contradiction. My first theological cry burst forth with the publication of Black Theology and Black Power in 1969. I found my voice in the social, political, religious, and cultural context of the civil rights and black power movements in the 1960s. The Newark and Detroit riots in July 1967 and the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. in April 1968 were the events that shook me out of my theological complacency, forcing me to realize the bankruptcy of any theology in America that did not engage in the religious meanings of the African-American struggle for justice. What I studied in graduate school ignored white supremacy and black resistance against it, as if they had nothing to do with the Christian gospel and the discipline of theology. Silence on both white supremacy and the black struggle against racial segregation made me angry with a fiery rage that had to find expression. How could any theologian explain the meaning of Christian identity in America and fail to engage white supremacy, its primary negation? I concluded that it was my responsibility to address the great contradiction white supremacy poses for Christianity in America. Published 3 months before I arrived at Union Theological Seminary in New York, Black Theology and Black Power was followed by A Black Theology of Liberation, 1970, The Spirituals and the Blues, 1972, and God of the Oppressed, 1975. In my next work, Martin and Malcolm and America, A Dream or a Nightmare, 1991, I returned explicitly to the two figures whose influence had combined implicitly to shape the theme and style of black liberation theology. Most people rejected one and embraced the other, seeing Martin and Malcolm as rivals, nemeses, representing oppositional categories of Christian and black, integration and separation, nonviolence and violence, love and hate. I embraced them both because I saw them advocating different methods that corrected and complemented each other as they worked for the same goal, the liberation of black people from white supremacy. Just as I could not separate Martin from Malcolm, neither could I separate my Christian identity from my blackness. I was black before I was Christian. My initial challenge was to develop a liberation theology that could be both black and Christian at the same time and in one voice. That was not easy because even in the black community, the public meaning of Christianity was white. Martin King and Malcolm X gave me intellectual resources and the spiritual courage to attack white supremacy. In earlier reflections on the Christian faith and white supremacy, I had focused on the social evils of slavery and segregation. How could whites confess and live the Christian faith and also impose 3.5 centuries of slavery and segregation upon black people? Self-interest and power corrupted their understanding of the Christian gospel. How could powerless blacks endure and resist the brutality of white supremacy in nearly every aspect of their lives and still keep their sanity? I concluded that an imminent presence of a transcendent revelation, confirming for blacks that they were more than what whites said about them, gave them an inner spiritual strength to cope with anything that came their way. I wrote because words were my weapons to resist, to affirm black humanity, and to defend it. And yet, through all this time, I avoided dealing directly with the reality of lynching. As a Southern black, the subject brought back such painful feelings. But finally, I had no choice. The subject chose me. This symbol of white supremacy was like a wild beast that had seized me by the neck, trying to kill me, and I had to fight it before I could fully live. Reading and writing about the lynching nightmare, looking at many images of tortured black bodies, has been my deepest challenge and the most painful experience I have had as a theologian. At times, it was almost too heavy for me to bear. The more I read about and looked at what whites did to powerless blacks, the angrier I became. Paradoxically, anger soon gave way to a profound feeling of liberation. Being able to write about lynching liberated me from being confined by it. The cross helped me to deal with the brutal legacy of the lynching tree, and the lynching tree helped me to understand the tragic meaning of the cross. In writing this book, my primary concern is to give voice to black victims, to let them and their families and communities speak to us, exploring the question, how did ordinary blacks, like my mother and father, survive the lynching atrocity and still keep together their families, their communities, and not lose their sanity? How could they live meaningful lives, knowing that they could be lynched for any small violation of what Richard Wright called the ethics of living Jim Crow? I wrestle with the questions about Black dignity in a world of white supremacy because I believe that the cultural and religious resources in the Black experience could help all Americans cope with the legacy of white supremacy and also deal more effectively with what is called the war on terror. If white Americans could look at the terror they inflicted on their own Black population, slavery, segregation, and lynching, then they might be able to understand what is coming at them from others. Black people know something about terror because we have been dealing with legal and extra-legal white terror for several centuries. Nothing was more terrifying than the lynching tree. I do not write this book as the last word about the cross and the lynching tree. I write it in order to start a conversation, so we can explore the many ways to heal the deep wounds lynching has inflicted upon us. The cross can heal and hurt. It can be empowering and liberating, but also enslaving and oppressive. There is no one way in which the cross can be interpreted. I offer my reflections because I believe that the cross placed alongside the lynching tree can help us see Jesus in America in a new light and thereby empower people who claim to follow him to take a stand against white supremacy and every kind of injustice. 1. Nobody knows the trouble I see. The cross and the lynching tree in the Black experience. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. Acts chapter 10, verse 39. Hundreds of Kodaks clicked all morning at the scene of the lynching. People in automobiles and carriages came from miles around to view the corpse dangling from the end of a rope. Picture cards, photographers installed a portable printing plant at the bridge and reaped a harvest in selling the postcards showing a photograph of the lynched Negro. Women and children were there by the score. At a number of country schools, the day's routine was delayed until boy and girl pupils could get back from viewing the lynched man. The Crisis 10, Number 2, June 1915, on the lynching of Thomas Brooks in Fayette County, Tennessee. The paradox of a crucified Savior lies at the heart of the Christian story. That paradox was particularly evident in the first century when crucifixion was recognized as the particular form of execution reserved by the Roman Empire for insurrectionists and rebels. It was a public spectacle, accompanied by torture and shame, one of the most humiliating and painful deaths ever devised by human beings. That Jesus died this way required special explanation. It made no rational or even spiritual sense to say that hope came out of a place called Golgotha, a place of the skull. For the Jews of Jesus' time, the punishment of crucifixion held special opprobrium, given their belief that anyone hung on a tree is under God's curse. Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 23. Thus, St. Paul said that the word of the cross is foolishness to the intellect and a stumbling block to established religion. The cross is a paradoxical religious symbol because it inverts the world's value system with the news that hope comes by way of defeat, that suffering and death do not have the last word, that the last shall be first, and the first last. That God could make a way out of no way in Jesus' cross was truly absurd to the intellect, yet profoundly real in the souls of Black folk. Enslaved Blacks who first heard the gospel message seized on the power of the cross. Christ crucified manifested God's loving and liberating presence in the contradictions of Black life. That transcendent presence in the lives of Black Christians that empower them to believe that ultimately, in God's eschatological future, they would not be defeated by the troubles of this world, no matter how great and painful their suffering. Believing this paradox, this absurd claim of faith, was only possible through God's amazing grace and the gift of faith grounded in humility and repentance. There was no place for the proud and the mighty, for people who think that God called them to rule over others. The cross was God's critique of power, white power, with powerless love snatching victory out of defeat. The sufferings of black people during slavery are too deep for words. That suffering did not end with emancipation. The violence and oppression of white supremacy took different forms and employed different means to achieve the same end, the subjugation of black people. And Christian theology for African Americans maintained the same great challenge to explain from the perspective of history and faith how life could be made meaningful in the face of death, how hope could remain alive in the world of Jim Crow segregation. These were the challenges that shaped black religious life in the United States. At no time was the struggle to keep such hope alive more difficult than during the lynching era, 1880 to 1940. The lynching tree is the most potent symbol of the trouble nobody knows that blacks have seen, but do not talk about because the pain of remembering, visions of black bodies dangling from southern trees, surrounded by jeering white mobs, is almost too excruciating to recall. In that era, the lynching tree joined the cross as the most emotionally charged symbols in the African American community, symbols that represented both death and the promise of redemption, judgment and the offer of mercy, suffering and the power of hope. Both the cross and the lynching tree represented the worst in human beings, and at the same time, an unquenchable ontological thirst for life that refuses to let the worst determine our final meaning. Lynching has a complicated and dramatic meaning in American history. Since the publication of Jacqueline Dowd Hall's Revolt Against Chivalry, 1979, many historians have been investigating lynching and have even discovered most of the names of the nearly 5,000 African-American victims. Initially, lynching was not directed primarily against blacks, nor did it always mean death to the victim. Mexicans, Indians, Chinese, and whites were lynched, a term that could be applied to whipping, shooting, stabbing, as well as hanging. Lynching was an extra-legal punishment sanctioned by the community. Many scholars date its origin in Virginia during the Revolutionary War when Charles Lynch, or William Lynch, both were called the original Judge Lynch, with the support of the community, punished Tory sympathizers. As communities moved westward, out of the reach of the courts, Judge Lynch was invoked to punish rustlers, robbers, wife abusers, and others who committed what a community perceived as outrageous deeds. Lynching was not regarded as an evil thing, but a necessity. The only way a community could protect itself from bad people out of reach of the law. Many Western movies show a romanticized view of lynching as hanging rustlers or bank robbers and murderers. During nearly 2.5 centuries of slavery, blacks were considered valuable property. Their owners usually protected their investment as they would their cows, horses, and other articles of value. Slaveholders whipped and raped slaves, violating them in any way they thought necessary, but they did not lynch them, except in the case of those who threatened the slave system itself, such as Gabriel Prosser, Denmark Vesey, Nat Turner, and other insurrectionists. The lynching of black America marked an important turning point in the history and meaning of lynching, as the racial component of lynching changed its meaning for both whites and blacks. Lynching, as primarily mob violence and torture directed against blacks, began to increase after the Civil War and the end of slavery, when the 1867 Congress passed the Reconstruction Act, granting black men the franchise and citizenship rights of participation in the affairs of government. Most Southern whites were furious at the very idea of granting ex-slaves social, political, and economic freedom. The Ku Klux Klan initially organized a social club in Pulaski, Tennessee, 1866, soon transformed itself into a vigilante group whose primary purpose was to redeem the South and thereby ensure that America remained a white man's country. Many felt that it was one thing to lose the war to the North, but quite another to allow ignorant, uncivilized niggers to rule over whites or even participate with them in the political process. White supremacists felt insulated by the suggestion that whites and blacks might work together as equals. Whether in the churches, colleges, and universities, or in the political and social life of the nation, Southern whites, who were not going to allow their ex-slaves to associate with them as equals, felt that if lynching were the only way to keep ex-slaves subservient, then it was necessary. During the Reconstruction era, the South was divided into military districts, which provided blacks some protection from mob violence so that the Klan had to do its violent work against blacks and their white northern sympathizers in secret, at night, wearing hoods to hide its members' identity. When KKK members were tried in courts, they could usually count on their neighbors and friends to find them not guilty, since all white male juries almost never found white men guilty of lynching a black man. The White South's perspective on the Reconstruction was told in Thomas Dixon's enormously popular novel, The Leopard's Spots, 1902, which sold over 1 million copies. It was followed by The Klansman, 1905. Both novels portrayed the Klan as redeemers of the South. D.W. Griffith transformed Dixon's novels into that cinematic masterpiece of racist propaganda, The Birth of a Nation, 1915. First seen at the White House, and praised enthusiastically by President Woodrow Wilson. Whites, especially in the South, loved birth and regarded seeing it as a religious experience. It rendered lynching an efficient and honorable act of justice and served to help reunite the North and South as a white Christian nation at the expense of African Americans. After seeing birth, one white man in Kentucky left the theater so excited that he shot and killed a 15-year-old African-American high school student. By 1930, according to one report, 90% of white Southerners had seen birth. Following Reconstruction and the removal of federal troops from the South, 1877, the black dream of freedom turned into a nightmare worse than slavery, initiating what black historian Rayford Logan called the nadir in black history, and what journalist Douglas A. Blackman appropriately called slavery by another name. Assured of no federal interference, Southern whites were now free to take back the South, to redeem it from what they called Negro domination through mob violence, excluding blacks from politics, arresting them for vagrancy, forcing them to work as sharecroppers who never got out of debt, and creating a rigid, segregated society in which being black was a badge of shame with no meaningful future. A black person could be lynched for any perceived insult to whites. A white from Florida told a northern critic, "The people from the South don't think any more of killing the black fellows than you would think of killing a flea." A black Mississippian recalled lynching with these words, "Back in them days, to kill a Negro wasn't nothing. It was like killing a chicken or killing a snake. The whites would say, 'Niggers just supposed to die. Ain't no damn good anyway. So just go and kill 'em.'" A firm advocate of white supremacy and even lynching in cases of rape, Bishop Atticus G. Haygood of the Methodist Church complained in 1893 that, "Nowadays it seems the killing of Negroes is not so extraordinary an occurrence as to need an explanation. It has become so common that it no longer surprises. We read such things as we read of fires that burn a cabin or a town." "Their blackness alone," writes historian Joe Williamson in his influential text, The Crucible of Race, "was license enough to line them up against walls, to menace them with guns, to search them roughly, beat them, and rob them of every vestige of dignity." Although white Southerners lost the Civil War, they did not lose the cultural war. The struggle to define America as a white nation and blacks as a subordinate race unfit for governing and therefore incapable of political and social equality. In the white imagination, the image of black men was transformed from docile slaves and harmless sambos to menacing, black beast rapists, the most serious threat to the virtue of white women and the sanctity of the white home. The image of black women was changed from nurturing Negro mammies to salacious Jezebels, nearly as corrupting to white civilization as black men. The claim that whites had the right to control the black population through lynching and other extralegal forms of mob violence was grounded in the religious belief that America is a white nation, called by God to bear witness to the superiority of white over black. Even prominent religious scholars in the North, like the highly regarded Swiss-born church historian Philip Schaff of Union Theological Seminary in New York, 1870 to 1893, believe that the Anglo-Saxon and Anglo-American of all modern races possess the strongest national character and the one best fitted for universal dominion. Such beliefs made lynching defensible and even necessary for many whites. Cole Bleece, the two-time U.S. governor and U.S. senator from South Carolina, proclaimed that lynching is a divine right of the Caucasian race to dispose of the offending blackamoor without the benefit of jury. Lynching was the white community's way of forcibly reminding blacks of their inferiority and powerlessness. To be black meant that whites could do anything to you and your people, and that neither you nor anyone else could do anything about it. The Supreme Court Chief Justice Roger B. Taney had said clearly in the Dred Scott decision, 1857, blacks had no rights which the white man was bound to respect. For many whites, whether in the North or the South, that conviction was unaffected by the end of slavery. But now, without slavery to control blacks, new means had to be devised, and even a new rationale for control. This was supplied by black men's imagined insatiable lust for white women. Because of their threat to white womanhood, black men must be carefully watched and violently kept in their place, segregated and subordinated. Sexual intercourse between black men and white women was regarded as the worst crime blacks could commit against Anglo-Saxon civilization. Even when sexual relations were consensual, race mixing, mockingly called mongrelization, was always translated to mean rape, and it was used as the primary justification of lynching. It was the moral and Christian responsibility of white men to protect the purity of their race by any means necessary. During the late 19th and early 20th centuries, it would have been difficult to find white persons who would openly object to the right of white men to protect white women from sexual union with black men by means of lynching. William Van Amberg Sullivan, a former U.S. senator from Mississippi, boasted, "I led the mob which lynched Nels Patton, and I am proud of it. I directed every movement of the mob, and I did everything I could to see that he was lynched." Even presidents refused to oppose lynching publicly, and some even supported it. As Theodore Roosevelt said, "The greatest existing cause of lynching is the perpetration, especially by black men, of the hideous crime of rape, the most abominable in all the category of crimes, even worse than murder." On the other hand, black men's assertion of their right to protect their daughters, sisters, wives, mothers, and other women from unwelcome advances from white men could bring down the full weight of Judge Lynch. Threats of lynching were often more effective than the act itself. In his autobiography, Born to Rebel, Benjamin E. Mays, the great president of Morehouse College in Atlanta and teacher of Martin Luther King Jr., recalled the occasion when a white mob confronted him and his father when he was just a child. "A crowd of white men rode up on horseback with rifles on their shoulders. I was with my father when they rode up, and I remember starting to cry. They cursed my father, drew their guns, and made him salute, made him take off his hat and bow down to them several times. Then they rode away. I was 5 years old, but I've never forgotten them." White mob violence against African Americans was an obsession in the South. It was not limited to that region. White supremacy was, and is, an American reality. Whites lynched blacks in nearly every state, including New York, Minnesota, and California. Wherever blacks were present in significant numbers, the threat of being lynched was always real. Blacks had to watch their step, no matter where they were in America. A black man could be walking down the road, minding his business, and his life could suddenly change by meeting a white man or a group of white men or boys who on a whim decided to have some fun with a Negro. And this could happen in Mississippi or New York, Arkansas, or Illinois. By the 1890s, lynching fever gripped the South, spreading like cholera, as white communities made blacks their primary target and torture their focus. Burning the black victim slowly for hours was the chief method of torture. Lynching became a white media spectacle in which prominent newspapers, like the Atlanta Constitution, announced to the public the place, date, and time of the expected hanging and burning of black victims. Often as many as 10 to 20,000 men, women, and children attended the event. It was a family affair, a ritual celebration of white supremacy, where women and children were often given the first opportunity to torture black victims, burning black flesh and cutting off genitals, fingers, toes, and ears as souvenirs. Postcards were made from the photographs taken of black victims with white lynchers and onlookers smiling as they struck a pose for the camera. They were sold for 10 to 25 cents to members of the crowd, who then mailed them to relatives and friends, often with a note saying something like this: "This is the barbecue we had last night." Spectacle lynchings attracted people from nearby cities and towns. They could not have happened without widespread knowledge and the explicit sanction of local and state authorities, and with the tacit approval from the federal government, members of the white media, churches, and universities. Lynching became so prevalent that the Boston branch of the Colored National League sent a letter to President William McKinley demanding action. "We have suffered, sir, since your accession to office, from the hate and violence of people claiming to be civilized but who are not civilized, and you have seen our sufferings. Yet you have at no time and on no occasion opened your lips on our behalf. Is there no help in the federal arm for us, or even one word of audible pity, protest, and remonstrance? Black indeed we are, sir, but we are also men and citizens." Like others in his office, McKinley refused to condemn lynching publicly. Even after the infamous Wilmington, North Carolina race riot of 1898, during which 11 blacks were killed and thousands were driven from the city in order to prevent them from participating in politics. When the anti-lynching Dyer bill was passed in the House of Representatives, January 26, 1922, many blacks hoped that President Warren G. Harding, a Republican, the party of Lincoln, would urge the Senate to do the same. Ara Lee Settle of Armstrong Technical High School, Washington, D.C., wrote to him, June 18, 1922, calling his attention to the importance of an anti-lynching law for the black community. "Mr. President," she wrote, "imagine yourself about to be lynched for something of which you know nothing about. Men seize you from some place of refuge, carry you to the heart of town, place a rope around you and burn you, while men and women and children are jeering you amidst all your pain and agony. It is enough to make one ashamed not to use his full influence against this horrible crime." Yet Harding, like most whites, was unmoved by black suffering. No one in America could claim that they did not know that whites were lynching blacks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.